Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents How the Irish Saved Civilization by Thomas Cahill.
The word Irish is seldom coupled with the word civilization. When we think of peoples as civilized or civilizing, the Egyptians and the Greeks, the Italians and the French, the Chinese and the Jews may all come to mind. The Irish are wild, feckless and charming, or morose, repressed and corrupt, but not especially civilized. If we strain to think of Irish civilization, no image appears, no fertile crescent or Indus Valley, no brooding bust of Beethoven. The simplest Greek auto mechanic will name his establishment Parthenon, thus linking himself to an imagined ancestral culture. But an Irish businessman is far more likely to name his concern the Breffni Bar or Kelly's Movers, announcing a merely local or personal connection, unburdened by the resonances of history or civilization. And yet, Ireland, a little island at the edge of Europe that has known neither Renaissance nor Enlightenment, had one moment of unblemished glory. For as the Roman Empire fell, as all through Europe, matted, unwashed barbarians descended on the Roman cities, looting artifacts and burning books, the Irish, who were just learning to read and write, took up the great labor of copying all of Western literature, everything they could lay their hands on. These scribes then served as conduits through which the Greco-Roman and Judeo-Christian cultures were transmitted to the tribes of Europe, newly settled amid the rubble and ruined vineyards of the civilization they had overwhelmed. Without this service of the scribes, everything that happened subsequently would have been unthinkable. Without the mission of the Irish monks, who single-handedly refounded European civilization throughout the continent in the bays and valleys of their exile, the world that came after them would have been an entirely different one, a world without books. And our own world would never have come to be. Not for 1,000 years, not since the Spartan Legion had perished at the hot gates of Thermopylae, had Western civilization been put to such a test or faced such odds. Nor would it again face extinction till in this century it devised the means of extinguishing all life. As our story opens at the beginning of the 5th century, no one could foresee the coming collapse. It never occurred to the Romans that the building blocks of their world would be saved by outlandish oddities from a land so marginal that the Romans had not bothered to conquer it, by men so strange they lived in little huts on rocky outcrops and shaved half their heads and tortured themselves with fasts and chills and nettle baths. We begin our story, though, not in Ireland, but in the orderly, predictable world of Rome. For in order to appreciate the significance of the Irish contribution, we need first to take an inventory of the civilized empire of late antiquity. On the last cold day of December, in the dying year we count as 406, the River Rhine froze solid, providing the natural bridge that hundreds of thousands of hungry men, women, and children had been waiting for. They were the barbarians. To the Romans, an undistinguished, matted mass of others, not terrifying, just troublemakers, annoyances, things one would rather not have to deal with, non-Romans. Neither the weary, disciplined Roman soldiers ranked along the west bank, nor the anxious, helter-skelter tribes amassing on the east bank could have been giving much thought to their place in history. But this moment of relative calm before the pandemonium to follow gives us the chance to study the actors on both sides of this river and to look backward on what has been and forward to what will be. Ascending heavenward like the Roman eagle, we can view the Rhine, widest river in Europe, rising out of Lake Constance in the Northern Alps, bending and bowing north, then northwest, till after 820 miles of travel, it reaches the coast of continental Europe and empties into the North Sea just opposite the Thames estuary. Returning to our Alpine heights, we can spot another river, rising from a smaller lake just north of Constance and coursing east for more than twice the length of the Rhine, till it spends itself in the Black Sea. This is the Danube, Europe's longest river after the Volga. To the north and east of these two alpine rivers live the barbarians. To the south and west lies Romania, in its time the vastest and most powerful empire in human history. That Rome should ever fall was unthinkable to Romans. Its foundations were unassailable, sturdily sunk in a storied past and steadily built on for 11 centuries and more. Eternal Rome hardly foresaw its doom. But theories about its fall are very old indeed and have defined the limits of all later interpretation. Either Rome fell because of inner weakness, social or spiritual, or Rome fell because of outer pressure, the barbarian hordes. What we can say with confidence is that Rome fell gradually, and that Romans for many decades scarcely noticed what was happening. Clues to the character of the Roman blindness are present in this scene along the frozen Rhine. The legionnaires on the Roman bank know that they have the upper hand, and that they always will have. Even though some are only half-civilized recruits recently settled on this side of the river, they are now Romans, inheritors of nearly 12 centuries of civilization. The world has never known anything as deep, as lasting, or as extensive as Pax Romana, the peace and predictability of Roman civilization. Inspecting the Roman soldiers now, we note the quiet authority of their presence and the polish of their person. More than this, there is an aesthetic to each gesture and accoutrement. All details have been considered. Their hair is cut with a thought to the shape of the head. They are clean shaving to show off the resoluteness of the jawline. Their dress, from their impregnable but shapely breastplates to their easy movement skirts, is designed with the form and movement of the body in mind. And their hard physiques recall the proportions of Greek statuary. Even the food in the mess is prepared to be not only savory to the taste, but attractive to the eye. We look out across the river to the barbarian hosts, who in the slanting gray light of winter mass like figures in a nightmare. Their hair, both of head and face, is uncut, vilely dressed with oil, braided into abhorrent shapes. Their bodies are distorted by ornament and discolored by paint. Some of the men are huge and muscular to the point of deformity, their legs wrapped comically in breeches. There is no discipline among them. They bellow at each other and race about in chaos. They are dirty and they stink. A crone in a filthy blanket stirs a cauldron, slicing roots and bits of rancid meat into the concoction from time to time. This unequal portrait of the two forces would not only have been the Roman view, it could almost have been the German view as well, for the milling hosts of Vandals, Alans, and Swaves are of Germanic origin, as are all the intruders of this period. To the Romans, the German tribes were riffraff. To the Germans, the Roman side of the river was the place to be. When at last the hapless Germans make their charge across the bridge of ice, it is head-on, without forethought or strategy. With preposterous courage, they team across the Rhine in convulsive waves, their principal weapon, their own desperation. We get a sense of their numbers, as well as their desperation, in a single casualty count. The Vandals alone are thought to have lost 20,000 men, not counting women and children, at the crossing. Despite their discipline, the Romans cannot hold back the Germanic sea. Why was the border guard so thin? Did the Romans not notice, at some point, that their way of life was changing forever? Did they not think to do something about it besides bow to the inevitable? What were they thinking about? In order to answer these questions and gain a fuller picture of Roman society, we turn to a typical Roman who helped to build the world of late antiquity. The barbarian onslaught across the frozen Rhine occurred in the first decade of the 5th century. Let us step back a bit into the 4th century and meet a man whose style of life can show us some of the yawning absences in Roman society, absences that would lead directly to the calamities of the 5th century. He is Ausonius the poet, and he kept an impressively large, exquisitely maintained country estate in Bordeaux in the province of Gaul, and after his father's death, another equally impressive estate in Aquitaine. He was born just 100 years before the German migration over the Rhine. Ausonius's poetry is full of endless sequences about forebears, about former teachers, about daily life, about classical subjects, the heroes of the Trojan War, the 12 Caesars, endless word games and endless imitations of Virgil. But there is almost never a memorable phrase, just high-class jingles written to formula. How could a grown man have spent so much time so foolishly? Well, it's what everyone else was doing. Civilized life, like the cultivation of Ausonius.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.